Timeline of the attack. We examine the sequence of events during the assault on the Capitol by a mob of Trump supporters. And a fractured summit. President Biden leads a meeting of nations from the Western Hemisphere, but the absence of several key leaders raises questions of whether the gathering can effectively address critical issues. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Fidelity. Dedicated advisors are here to help you create a wealth plan. A plan with tax-sensitive investing strategies. Planning focused on tomorrow, while you focus on today. That's the planning effect from Fidelity.
The Candida Fund, committed to advancing restorative justice and meaningful work through investments in transformative leaders and ideas. More at CandidaFund.org. Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at Carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
The Congressional Committee investigating the January 6th attack on the U.S. Capitol is unveiling the first details of its findings tonight in a primetime televised hearing. It is the culmination of nearly a year of investigation into the events on and before January 6th, as former President Donald Trump worked to overturn the results of the 2020 election. President Joe Biden reflected on the committee's work earlier today.
As I said, when it was occurring and subsequent, I think it was a clear, flagrant violation of the Constitution. I think these guys and women broke the law, tried to turn around the result of an election. And there's a lot of questions, who's responsible, who's involved. I'm not going to make a judgment on that, but I just want to know that, I want you to know that we're going to probably be, a lot of Americans are going to be seeing for the first time some of the detail that occurred.
Tonight is just the first of a series of public hearings that will take place over the next few weeks. Our Lisa Desjardins is at the Capitol, and she joins me now. So hello, Lisa. So much anticipation about these hearings. Tell us what we should expect tonight, and what are you looking for?
All right. This is an unusual night, Judy. Obviously, January 6th itself is historically unique. So is this committee unique, and so will this hearing in prime time be unique. I think at the top of the agenda for this committee tonight will be to try and depict January 6th in very real terms. We all remember the video that we've seen. Some members of this committee are concerned that Americans no longer take it as seriously as they do here at the Capitol. These images, as we've seen before, we're going to see more images like them tonight, but images that we have never seen before. The idea to really, the reality of the danger, make that kind of even more present in American minds tonight. We'll also see some interviews that the committee has been doing behind closed doors, including, we believe, with the Trump family, Trump officials, all of those things. And all of this, Judy, the main point that the committee is going to make, one of the main points that they will preview tonight, is the role of former President Trump. They will try and make a case, according to the committee aides, that this was a multi-step conspiracy that led to January 6th and that President Trump himself was central to it. Of course, the former president and his allies and Republicans here deny that. But I will tell you, it's a big night for this committee. Just to review what they've been doing, the work that has been underway for this committee. This is a committee that was created just over a year ago at the end of June in 2021 by a House vote, a vote by the full House. And it has interviewed over 1,000 witnesses so far, issued 100 subpoenas. If you look at those subpoenas, the largest group of those are for Trump officials and those, it seems, that the committee believes were helped organize that rally on January 6th. Lastly tonight, what should viewers expect? As you can hear the noise outside the Capitol, probably over a microphone. Tonight, about a 90-minute hearing in prime time. We do expect a break at one point in it. There will be two live witnesses in addition to all of the video testimony tonight.
And of course, at the same time, Lisa, we know the vast majority of Republicans in the House did not vote for this committee. What are their leaders saying about these hearings?
That's correct. I think let's look at the problem, the divide in the House, by looking at the composition of the committee itself. If you look at the members of the committee, the two that you see there with the red around them, Liz Cheney, Adam Kinzinger, those are the only two Republicans who support this committee. They are sitting on it. And if you look at all the members, this committee all on one mindset. They all believe there is a conspiracy here. But Judy, you're right. The rest of the Republicans in the House disagree. They don't believe in this committee. They don't support it. And what they say is that this is a political act. I want to play for you the sort of different mindsets today from the leaders of the party, first House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, and then Republican leader Kevin McCarthy, on how they see this committee and these hearings.
The narrative of what happened as an assault on our democracy, on our Constitution, on our Capitol, on our Congress, in a very violent way.
It is the most political and least legitimate committee in American history. It has used congressional subpoenas to attack Republicans, violate due process, and infringe on the political speech of private citizens.
This is another important decision point for this country, Judy, the idea of, is January 6th and political violence still a danger for this country, which is what the hearing will try and lay out, or is it something in the past, which is what those Republicans and their leaders are saying?
And Lisa, we know that while all this is going on, there's yet another big issue before the Congress right now. That's gun violence in the wake of these terrible shootings in Uvalde, Texas, and Buffalo, New York. Reminder, there was yet another shooting just today near Washington, D.C., the small town of Smithburg, Maryland, not too far from Camp David, where presidents go on their weekends. Three people killed, at least one or two wounded, reminding us again of what a big problem it is. Lisa, what in your conversations with lawmakers and what are you seeing in the public polling about what the public wants done about gun violence?
I think public opinion is affecting the debate right now in the U.S. Senate, and we're seeing that in polling that we just got today from our PBS NewsHour NPR Marist polling, which says that almost 60% of Americans believe that protecting against gun violence is more important than gun rights. Now, I want to drill down on specifically what people think and how that might affect politics here in Capitol. When we asked, would you definitely vote for someone who voted for stricter gun laws? If you look at by party, huge difference. 93% of Democrats would vote for someone who supports stricter gun laws, just 28% of Republicans. Independents, by a slim majority, want stricter gun laws in their representatives here on the Capitol. They want them supporting them. But look at this, Judy. Look at when you look at these numbers by generation. I found this so fascinating. We are divided by our politics, but not very much by our age. There you see Gen Z, the younger generations, do by a little bit support stricter gun laws. But every other generation, also Gen X, baby boomers, also a majority by age, support stricter gun laws. And we are seeing phone calls and those kinds of things, I think, having an effect here on the Hill.
And Lisa, as you were reporting in the last day or so, there have been a vote in the House of Representatives just last night. You've been watching talks in the Senate on guns. What do you see? Where do things stand right now?
A very interesting day today. Senator Mitt Romney of Utah came out and said that he wants the age to be raised to buy assault-style weapons. However, Senator John Cornyn of Texas, who is a leading Republican in Senate talks, said he will not allow that to happen. But we do see progress, and I think the quiet on this, these negotiations is a good kind of quiet. There still is a chance for something to come out of this.
And I know you are following that along with these January 6th hearings. Lisa Desjardins at the Capitol, thank you.
You're welcome.
While House Democrats plan to shed new light on the events of January the 6th during the public hearings, much is already known about what happened that day, thanks to thousands of videos and firsthand accounts of people who were there, including some of our own reporters and producers. Amna Nawaz takes a look back at that historic and deadly day.
USA! USA!
January 6th, 2021. Trump supporters from across the country gathered in the nation's capital to protest Congress's certification of the 2020 presidential election results.
To use a favorite term that all of you people really came up with, we will stop the steal.
At a rally near the White House, President Trump spoke to a crowd estimated in the thousands, everyone from ordinary Americans to conspiracy theorists.
Proud Boys.
To members of right-wing extremist groups.
We will never give up. We will never concede.
Trump repeated the lie that the election was stolen, urging his supporters to march to the Capitol and fight.
You'll never take back our country with weakness. We fight like hell. And if you don't fight like hell, you're not going to have a country anymore.
Around 1 p.m., as Trump is wrapping up his remarks in the park, the day turned violent. A group of his supporters on the western side of the Capitol confront the handful of police guarding the barriers and force their way through. Moments after Mr. Trump finished his more than hour-long speech, thousands of protesters streamed from that rally site directly to the U.S. Capitol grounds. Several people told us that day they expected Vice President Pence to overturn the 2020 election results.
What needs to happen today is Vice President Pence needs to not open the seven state electors' envelopes for the states that I mentioned. Set them aside and send it all back to those state legislatures.
We got to stop this steal from happening because if we don't, nobody's ever going to vote again. There's not going to be any integrity in our voting system.
As the crowd grows, clashes between Trump supporters and Capitol police officers, clearly outnumbered, intensified.
We're not going to take it anymore. This is our country.
Outside, the Capitol's West Front became a battleground. Inside, the joint session of Congress to certify election results was underway. The traditionally ceremonial process is upended by Republicans, led by Representative Paul Gosar of Arizona and Senator Ted Cruz of Texas, challenging Trump's loss, sending lawmakers to their separate chambers to debate.
What does it say to the nearly half the country that believes this election was rigged if we vote not even to consider the claims of illegality and fraud in this election?
Meanwhile, around 2 p.m., the East Side barricades are breached. Here's what I saw from outside the Capitol.
Half an hour ago, vehicle barriers that had been set up about 100 yards away or so from the Capitol were first breached by a group of protesters. Capitol Hill police retreated a little bit more. Then hundreds more protesters started to stream up this walkway in front of the Capitol. It is a remarkable scene.
On the West Front, the mob tore down scaffolding, battled their way through the last line of police defense, and broke into the Capitol building itself. NewsHour congressional correspondent Lisa Desjardins was inside the building reporting live as it happened.
Judy, there are protesters. Protesters have now broken into the U.S. Capitol.
And it will stand in recess until the call of the chair.
The Senate was called into recess and evacuated. The mob of Trump supporters roamed the historic halls, damaging property and searching for lawmakers. Security footage captured the moment Capitol Police officer Eugene Goodman shuttled Republican Senator Mitt Romney of Utah to safety before running ahead to divert the approaching mob away from the Senate chamber. Rioters came within 100 feet of Vice President Mike Pence, whose security detail took him to safety from an office near the Senate. While this was happening, at 2:24 p.m., Trump tweeted from the White House, criticizing Pence for not having, quote, the courage to do what should have been done. Remarkably, the House was still in session when rioters attempted to break into that chamber. A police officer shot Ashley Babbitt, an Air Force veteran from California and QAnon conspiracy theorist, as she and a crowd tried to break into the rear of the chamber where some lawmakers were still sheltering.
According to an analysis from the New York Times, rioters breached the Capitol in at least 8 different places. They entered the Rotunda, Statuary Hall, and the Senate chamber. Some broke into the offices of lawmakers, including House Speaker Nancy Pelosi's. Law enforcement arrived to clear a hallway above Statuary Hall, where NewsHour correspondent Lisa Desjardins was sheltered.
But I do hear shouting as police seem to one by one be taking down the protesters, telling them to get on the ground, trying to control the situation.
Democratic Senator Patty Murray from Washington State spoke with Judy Woodruff about hiding in her office with her husband that day.
And we heard somebody saying, "We saw them, they're in one of these rooms." And they were pounding on our door and trying to open it. And my husband sat with his foot against the door, praying that it would not break in.
Meanwhile, outside, as crowds grew, so did the violence. Officers on site called for backup throughout the day. And while some reinforcements did arrive from local, state, and federal agencies, it took National Guard units about 3 hours to respond to the Capitol. Rioters, outnumbering law enforcement by more than 50-1, attacked, dragged, and beat police officers, crushing them underfoot and spraying them with chemicals.
They began to beat me with their fists and with what felt like hard metal objects.
In testimony to Congress, former D.C. Metro Police Officer Michael Fanone recounted being pulled into a crowd of protesters.
I was electrocuted again and again and again with a taser.
This is our Capitol!
In total, nearly 150 police officers were injured on the day. During the attack, those closest to President Trump privately urged him to take action and tell his supporters to stop the assault. House Republican leader Kevin McCarthy spoke with him from the besieged Capitol. His son, Donald Trump Jr., and several Fox hosts texted White House contacts, including Trump's chief of staff, Mark Meadows, to tell the president to address the crowd. Hours passed before President Trump did anything to address the insurrection. Just after 4 p.m., he released a video repeating unfounded claims about the election results.
I know your pain. I know you're hurt. We had an election that was stolen from us. It was a landslide election, and everyone knows it, especially the other side. But you have to go home now. We have to have peace.
Around this time, police began to secure the Capitol. Flashbangs and tear gas were used to clear the Western Terrace, the site of presidential inaugurations. Police declared the Capitol complex secure around 8 p.m.
To those who wreaked havoc in our Capitol today, you did not win.
In the early hours of the next day, January 7th, Congress finished certifying the election results. Some Senate Republicans withdrew their initial objections.
The chair declares the joint session dissolved.
A Capitol police officer, Brian Sicknick, suffered 2 strokes and died that evening. In the days and months following the attack, 4 police officers who were on duty died by suicide. More than 800 people have been charged with crimes linked to January 6th. The physical destruction of that day has since been cleaned up, but questions of how to repair the deeper damage to our democracy remain. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Amna Nawaz.
And to discuss more about what we do and do not know about January 6th and the days leading up to it, I'm joined by Donnell Harvin. He is the former head of Homeland Security and Intelligence for the District of Columbia. He's now a senior policy researcher with the RAND Corporation. And Andrea Bernstein, she's an investigative journalist and co-host of the Will Be Wild podcast. It's an 8-part series about the Capitol attack. And we welcome both of you to the NewsHour. Andrea Bernstein, I'm going to start with you. You've done so much reporting on this already. What are the main unanswered questions out there that you have about January the 6th?
It's great to be with you, Judy, and hello to Donnell, who we spoke to for our podcast. I mean, I think the biggest question that we still don't know is to what extent was the president and or his advisors aware of plans to attack the Capitol on January 6th. We do know a stunning amount of information now that we didn't know on January 6th about what President Trump, then President Trump, did. We know he pressured his vice president, Mike Pence, not to certify the vote. We know he pressured his acting attorney general, Jeffrey Rosen, to send a letter to state legislatures telling them not to send up slates of electors. We know that he contemplated asking the Department of Defense and the Department of Homeland Security to consider impounding election machines. So we know that all of that was going on in the president's mind. We also know that he tried to get the state of Georgia to find 11,780 votes. However, what we don't know is, did he know anything about the plans well-developed by early January, as we now know from the various prosecutions that have moved forward? Did he know about that? Were there any intermediaries? What kind of knowledge did he have of the specifics? So that's one of the things that I will be looking to see if the hearings answered. That said, even if they don't, it doesn't mean that the president didn't try to interfere with the peaceful transfer of power. We know that he did.
And Danelle Harvin, in your capacity at the time as the head of Homeland Security for the District of Columbia, you were seeing enough out there that worried you, that caused you to say to others that they should be prepared, that something was coming. What did you see?
Well, thank you for having me. We saw a lot of information, what we call intelligence, that suggested that this would happen. And be quite honest with you, you don't need to be a highly trained intelligence operative like my staff were to know that was coming. You can just open up Twitter or Facebook and see some of the vitriol that was going on around January 6th, which really was the bulk of what we were looking at. Our job is to kind of sift through those thousands, tens of thousands of posts and look for what we call posts of concern. Intelligence, bits of intelligence that we can string together, particularly from worrisome individuals or groups, that would lead us to think that the threat environment had changed or evolved. And we saw that evolve and get even worse in the weeks leading up to January 6th.
And you tried to get higher-ups around the government to do something about it. Many of your warnings were not heeded. Andrea Bernstein, you know, you were looking at what was going on with one of these extremist groups, the Proud Boys. What did you see in terms of planning on their part? What did you learn later about the planning on their part?
Well, I think that we knew from very early on, you could see it right in the videos, that members of the Proud Boys went to the Capitol early, before the president even had begun speaking in some cases, and were present for many of the pivotal events of that day. For example, breaching the initial outer barricades, breaking the windows, and getting into the Capitol that way. But what we learned this week in an indictment that was unveiled by the Department of Justice was that they had planned to attack the Capitol. They had a fairly sophisticated understanding, according to prosecutors, of how the constitutional process worked. They believed that if they could delay the certification, that it wouldn't be valid. They were prepared to provoke a constitutional crisis, according to these papers. Now, they've pleaded not guilty, but it's a very serious charge, and it is now the second seditious conspiracy case. There's another one against the Oath Keepers. In that case, the leader of the group wanted to contact the president on January 6th. We don't know why he thought he could, but that's one of the things we may learn in these hearings.
And Danelle Harvin, from where you sat watching all this closely, watching it unfold, reading Twitter and other online sources, how close do you think the country came to actually having a coup take place?
I think we came incredibly close, in my professional opinion. Lawmakers came within hundreds of feet or just minutes of an angry, violent mob. And I have no doubt that if they came across a lawmaker, irrespective of the party, that there would be a lot more than shouting. The other thing is that you look at the fragility of our democracy if it hangs on one individual doing what's morally and constitutionally right. And were it not for Mike Pence being able to be whisked away safely by his Secret Service detail and then returning to do the business of the government, we would have a different conversation quite possibly now. And so I'm really interested to see where the January 6th committee takes this. But I think that we came very, very close to having a constitutional crisis, as Andrea said. And we saw all this being played out online and before this, before January 6th. This is exactly what these groups were aligning together to do. It was to disrupt the constitutional process of the election and to stir a lot of people to come to D.C. And create anarchy, essentially.
And Andrea Bernstein, I know you've stayed in touch through your reporting with a number of these individuals who belong to these extremist groups. How do they look back on what happened, and what do they think of this committee process?
Well, I think one of the things that's very disturbing is that January 6th brought a lot of these groups together, and many of them remain defiant and unrepentant. And intelligence experts have told us that January 6th was a beginning, that we are still suffering from these same forces, and that we need to really examine what could happen in the future because these things have not gone away.
Danielle Harvin, just quickly, is your view the same, that you think these groups are still determined to do something?
Absolutely. Our domestic intelligence enterprise has assessed that many of the individuals that were not caught or arrested that day or didn't travel to D.C. Were upset that they didn't get an opportunity to do it, and they felt that they could have made a difference had they come to D.C. And so I think the fight's going back to the states.
Danielle Harvin, Andrea Bernstein, we thank you both.
I'm Vanessa Ruiz in for Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. Updating now our top story. The first day of the January 6th hearings just concluded on Capitol Hill. The House committee investigating the insurrection heard tonight from two witnesses who were at the Capitol that day. Documentary filmmaker Nick Quested, who was embedded with the far-right Proud Boys, and U.S. Capitol Police officer Caroline Edwards.
I documented the crowd turn from protesters to rioters to insurrectionists. I was surprised at the size of the group, the anger and the profanity. And for anyone who didn't understand how violent that event was, I saw it, I documented it, and I experienced it.
I was called Nancy Pelosi's dog, called incompetent, called a hero, and a villain. I was called a traitor to my country, my oath, and my constitution. In actuality, I was none of those things. I was an American, standing face to face with other Americans, asking myself how many times, many, many times, how we had gotten here.
In the day's other news, a Republican candidate for governor of Michigan, Ryan Kelly, was charged in the January 6th riot. Federal prosecutors said video shows him urging on the pro-Trump crowd. He faces several misdemeanor counts. Five other Republicans were already disqualified in the governor's race over forged signatures on their ballot petitions. And also in Michigan, a Grand Rapids policeman, Christopher Scher, now faces trial for second-degree murder for killing a black man during a traffic stop. Patrick Leoya was shot in the back of the head after struggling with Scher. Kent County Prosecutor Chris Becker announced his decision today, saying Leoya's death was not justified or excused by self-defense. And this evening, Grand Rapids Police Chief Eric Winstrom recommended firing Scher. Leaders in the U.S. House of Representatives clashed today over adding security for families of Supreme Court justices. Democrats delayed action until next week, hoping to expand protections to court employees. Speaker Nancy Pelosi said nobody is in danger over the weekend because of our not having a bill. Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy shot back, saying, "I don't know how she could say that, knowing that you just captured a person who wanted to kill Justice Brett Kavanaugh." Federal marshals arrested a man near Kavanaugh's home yesterday and charged him with attempted murder. The UN's nuclear watchdog says Iran is removing 27 surveillance cameras from its nuclear sites. That comes after the agency censured Tehran for failing to explain the discovery of uranium at undeclared sites. The UN cameras were installed under the 2015 nuclear deal. Today, the UN agency's chief warned their loss could be the fatal blow to enforcing that agreement.
What we are seeing is that because of the decision that has been announced to us today, is a decrease of the visibility that the agency is going to have about what's happening in Iran. And of course, this is something I deplore.
Then President Trump withdrew the U.S. from the nuclear deal in 2018. And since then, Iran has moved to enrich more uranium gas closer to weapons-grade levels. On the pandemic, experts reporting to the World Health Organization are calling for more research on how COVID originated. That includes whether the virus escaped in a lab accident in China. The expert panel says all reasonable possibilities should be considered. The WHO dismissed the lab accident theory last year, and China has called it baseless. Still to come on the News Hour, the absence of several key leaders raises questions about a meeting of Western Hemisphere nations. Also, an interactive museum that hopes to boost the love of words, and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington, and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
Leaders from across the Western Hemisphere are in Los Angeles this week for the Summit of the Americas. Last night, President Biden unveiled a new economic plan to help respond to the region's most pressing challenges, migration, climate change, and the pandemic. But these issues have been overshadowed by disagreements over who should participate. Here's John Yang.
In a city where the drama is usually on the big who's not at the Summit of the Americas is as much of the story as the gathering itself. Designed to be a show of hemispheric unity for almost the last 30 years, there's been discord over the guest list. Citing concerns over a lack of democracy, this year the host United States barred three nations.
One of the key elements of this summit is democratic governance. And these three countries are not exemplars, to put it mildly, of democratic governance.
Not invited, Cuba, with its nearly 65-year history of communism, Venezuela, where Nicolas Maduro has tightened his grip on power, and Nicaragua, where former Marxist Daniel Ortega was declared winner of his fourth consecutive election after jailing his rivals. In response, President Andrés Manuel López Obrador of Mexico, the U.S.'s second largest trading partner, refused to attend.
I believe we need to change the policy that has been imposed for centuries, a policy of exclusion and dominance that disregards the sovereignty of other countries.
The presidents of Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador are also skipping the meeting. Still, President Biden is unbound, speaking last night of cooperation, not exclusion.
No longer is this a question of what will we do, what will the United States do for the Americas? The question is what we can accomplish by working together.
Migration in the region is at unprecedented levels. More than 5 million Venezuelans are displaced across Latin America. Migrants from around the world cross the Colombia-Panama border, and a crisis continues to unfold at the U.S.-Mexico border. They're fleeing political and economic instability and a new wave of anti-establishment and authoritarian leaders. At the summit, Panama's foreign minister spoke for many.
What is happening in democracy is that there's a lot less trust in our leaders. The same thing is happening in all countries.
The Americas have also been devastated by natural disasters and the aftermath of the pandemic, another focus of this year's summit.
So let's use this summit to tackle the obstacles to growth. Come together around new ideas and new opportunities to take our region's biggest challenges on and defeat them.
But as the summit goes on, the diplomatic controversy is at the forefront, and the future of U.S. influence in the region uncertain.
The summit runs through tomorrow, and now two perspectives on this.
John Feely is the former U.S. ambassador to Panama. He's currently the executive director of the Center for Media Integrity of the Americas, a nonprofit that promotes public media in Latin America. And Arturo Sarracan previously served as Mexico's ambassador to the United States. He's now at the Brookings Institution. Gentlemen, thank you and welcome to you both. Mr. Feely, I want to start with you. Migration, a big issue. They want to get try to achieve something out of this. But without the leaders of Mexico, Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador, can something really meaningful come out of this meeting?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And, you know, it's a shame that they are not here. I think that it's also a shame that the issue of invitations wasn't decided a lot earlier, as has been done in past summits, for example, in 2015, when Cuba was involved and the hemisphere seemed to be able to accept it. You can make good arguments on both sides, but the bottom line is the invitation issue should have been put to bed a long time ago. With regard to the abstentions, however, by the Northern Triangle, the Central American and the Mexican president, I think, quite frankly, they're the losers in all of this. You know, it's interesting to note that they said they're not coming, but they did, in fact, all send their foreign ministers, a pretty good-sized delegations here. So it's pretty clear that they want to be in the room where it happens when these issues are being discussed. And I also think that President Biden and the Biden administration have put out a pretty practical call. We haven't seen the declaration yet, but to cooperate on migration. You know, a lot of these countries, especially Mexico, have historically been migrant-sending nations. Well, they're now receiving migrants. There's over 150,000 Haitians in Mexico, and Mexico really doesn't have a lot of experience in handling them. So I think something can be achieved. It won't happen at the summit. But it's a shame that they aren't represented at their highest levels.
Mr. Sarracan, the Northern Triangle countries, the losers, as Mr. Feely says, do you agree with that?
Look, I think it's very simple, John. You either sit at the table or you're on the menu. I don't want to suggest that these countries will be on the menu, but there is, and that's the reason why the foreign secretaries, as John says, are there. Now, having said that, you have to recognize that a lot of the legwork has already been done. That is, Mexico and the United States have been engaging with one another on migration issues for the good part of this year. There's been a very profound conversation as to how they can continue collaborating. So Mexico's absence, and maybe even some of the Central American nations, it does obviously, it's a political and diplomatic sandbagging. It's a diplomatic ambush of President Biden, which I think is extremely unfortunate, particularly coming from a country like mine, the U.S.'s number one trading partner. But at the end of the day, there's already enough muscle tone that has been building, particularly on migration collaboration, that I don't think will derail what the White House will unveil and present and hopefully start building upon in the coming weeks and months.
Mr. Feely, of course, what triggered all this was the non-invitations to Cuba, Venezuela, and Nicaragua. This was done in the name of fostering and promoting democracy, but there are a number of countries who are there, who did get invited, that are trending away from democracy. Where should the Biden administration have drawn the line in this effort to foster democracy? I'm sorry, Mr. Feely, we don't have your audio, so I'm going to ask that question, that same question. Let's ask that same question of Ambassador Sarracan. Was the United States justified in denying these other countries an invitation, yet also inviting countries that are sort of trending away from democracy?
It's hard to draw the line because, as you say, there are some countries that where you're starting to see some democratic erosion, Mexico, Brazil, two examples. But I think it's very clear that Venezuela, Cuba, and Nicaragua are in a category of their own, that the democratic destruction, in some cases erosion, is really dramatic. And I think that the administration was right in establishing this as a basic criteria. I think the countries of the Americas do need to be bound by at least a common set of principles regarding democracy and democratic resilience. Remember, every single country except Cuba signed an Inter-American Democratic Charter as a result of the Summit of the Americas in Quebec in 2001. So I think that in this regard, it's the right call. Now, having said this, obviously many countries in the Americas look at the U.S. and look at the U.S. engagement with other authoritarian regimes around the world, with which the United States has profound, constant, deep political diplomatic engagement, and some obviously see here a bit of a contradiction and some hypocrisy. But regardless, I think the Biden administration made the right call.
And of course, this also led to the leader of the nation you represented in Washington, of Mexico, not coming. This Mexico, arguably, along with Canada, the most important U.S. partner in the Americas. What do you think the effect of not having Mexico at the table is having on this meeting?
Well, this is a known goal for Mexico's interests in foreign policy. Again, if Uzbekistan was having the summit, you know, Mexico's relationship with Uzbekistan is minimal. But, you know, with $1.5 billion a day of trade going both in both directions, this is a significant, slap in the face of a relationship that should be built on a strategic vision for how Canada, the United States, and Mexico deepen our architectural footprint. We will have to wait and see. I think some of the reactions that we're already seeing on Capitol Hill, John, from both Democrats and Republicans who are concerned that the Mexican president's decision to sort of almost provide cover to these regimes in Cuba, Nicaragua, and Venezuela is a bad sign coming from, again, one of the United States' largest trading partners and a vital nation for the security, the well-being, and the prosperity of the United States.
Arturo Saracan, former Mexican ambassador to the United States. We apologize to Ambassador John Feely. We lost his audio, but we apologize for the technical difficulties.
The Planet Word Museum in Washington, D.C., described as the place that brings language to life, recently opened a new exhibit focused on wordplay. Jeffrey Brown takes a look at the many ways words make the world go round. It's part of our arts and culture series, Canvas.
About a third of English words are Germanic.
Words, 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 popping from the pages of books, revealing secrets.
We have not had time for a week.
In some 30 languages,
안녕하세요.
Through a speaking willow, even clean-cut only on bathroom walls.
How to make reading and words and language cool again and make them awesome. And my idea was, well, try a museum.
Ann Friedman is the founder and CEO of Planet Word, now occupying an historic building from 1869. Appropriately enough, a former school. Friedman may emphasize the fun side of the experience here, but she's a former elementary school reading instructor, and the idea for the museum began in response to a problem.
Statistics show, like, reading test scores at schools. They're stagnating at best, perhaps declining because of COVID. Surveys that showed that young people don't read a single book for pleasure during the year. So that's why I was despairing, because to my mind, if you don't have a literate, well-read population, it affects the strength of your democracy.
The focus here, she says, is on 10 to 12-year-olds, the age when many stop choosing to read. The way to reach them, through immersive experiences and themed rooms. Joking around with language tricks and humor.
Let this be the last time.
Lend me your ears, where visitors can see what goes into giving a speech.
They all love.
Inevitably, perhaps, a karaoke lounge to make some noise and hopefully learn what goes into songwriting.
So everything that you see,
mm-hmm,
is there for a reason.
The recently opened Lexicon Lane is a kind of word puzzle come to life, with clues spread throughout the room.
This is the lure?
Yes.
How do you think about it?
I love that word, lure.
Yeah?
Yes. Use technology to suck people in and give them an opportunity to try writing something, try reading something.
My name is Logan Grace, and my pronouns are they and them.
Or in a more serious vein, as in the Words Matter Gallery, show how words can help people define themselves or resist definition by others.
You may think that it is ignorant to speak broken English, but I'm here to tell you that even articulate Americans sound foolish to the British.
Or resist definition by others. How to reach young people and instill a love of words and language? That's also the goal of Jason Reynolds, best-selling author of 16 books. He serves as the Library of Congress's National Ambassador for Young People's Literature and as an advisor to Planet Word.
Planet Word is a space that does feel magical in certain ways, right? Because it takes this thing that is only, for young people especially, that's only sort of seen in school or seen as homework and turns it into something that is just ours, that feels familiar, that feels like it's a part of our everyday lives.
It's immersive, it's fun in the moment, but does it really engage and lead, especially young people, to words and reading beyond that experience?
I think it can. I think what I hope it does is that the adults of these young people, when they bring their young folk, but hopefully what they'll witness is once a young person's eyes are widened by the immersive experience, that they then say, we have all these different forms of literature, some of which are a little more immersive, or at least have multiple stimuli working simultaneously to engage a young person's whose attention span has grown to be so short these days. And I think that Planet Word makes a case for all those other forms of literature.
So what am I looking at?
You're looking at the word wall.
Hello, and welcome to Planet Word.
Another advisor, Colin Phillips, professor of linguistics at the University of Maryland. He was happy to play at the word wall, which demonstrates the origins of words and how they change over time, but also concerned about the ways technology and our political culture have made understanding language and how words work more critical than ever.
Language is a critical part of everything we do as humans, but we often don't give it much thought. We take it for granted. And I think what we've seen in the last few years is more and more the ways in which language has had a profound and sometimes damaging impact on the way on things that we do. The way in which technology has evolved and the way in which automatic analysis of language has developed in the recent years is much more powerful than it was even 10 years ago. And so getting people to reflect more on how language is important, how we use it, how it can be used against us is more and more important.
Along with colleagues at the University of Maryland, Gallaudet, and Howard Universities, Phillips is part of a team creating a new science lab at the museum to study language in a variety of projects. One new big question, the impact of the pandemic.
It's been very, very interesting for us as language learners seeing how the pandemic has changed the research. It has put people in different situations, led them to interact in different ways. They've been talking more through screens. Scientists are interested in, does that change the way in which we interact? Children have been exposed to a narrower range of voices. Does that make a difference to how they learn?
Can Planet Word have the impact its creators and advisors hope for? That answer, of course, is still to be written. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown at Planet Word in Washington, D.C.
It's a place you've got to see in Washington, Planet Word. And we'll be back shortly, but first, take a moment to hear from your local PBS station. It's a chance to offer your support, which helps to keep programs like ours on the air. For those stations staying with us, many Native American foods disappeared after European settlement in North America. But as special correspondent Fred DeSam Lazaro explains in this Encore report, one Minneapolis restaurant is trying to revive Native cuisine.
The city of Minneapolis has its roots in flour milling, its Mississippi riverfront today dotted with icons of that heritage. But a new centerpiece of this historic district is an enterprise with a very different take on that history.
There was a really important Dakota village right here on this side of the river where our restaurant sits. So for us,
you know, it's an act of reclamation because we're able to bring the true namesake of this space back.
Okay, right down here.
Yeah.
That namesake is Sean Sherman's restaurant called Owamni, swirling water in the Dakota language, and named after the much higher waterfalls that existed before industrialization brought dams. For Sherman and his life and work partner, Dana Thompson, the restaurant opening was timely, broadening the conversation about racial equity in a city still recovering in the aftermath of George Floyd's murder.
The fact that it happened, you know, during a pandemic, after the uprising, and all of the different layers of complexity, it's been a really important place to heal, to have space to have these really hard conversations about race and culture and food and equity and sustainability.
The more immediate conversation, however, has been about the food.
The verdict is,
wow.
Amazing flavors.
That's amazing.
Mm-hmm. Delicious.
Owamni's wide array of ingredients has some that have been revived after generations, and all of them are pre-colonial. That means no chicken, no pork, no dairy, and in a city that calls itself the Mill City, no wheat.
And we're just trying to keep it really simple.
Sherman says his recipes combine simple flavors and texture. Rabbit on a bed of kale, venison tartare, braised bison garnished with dandelion greens. Simple, perhaps, but good enough to earn a nomination for Best New Restaurant from the James Beard Foundation. From patrons we spoke with, two thumbs up.
It's naturally gluten-free and dairy-free, and the food was just absolutely spectacular.
And I'm excited about Native people reclaiming their heritage and sharing it with us, because we have a lot to learn from the people who were here before us.
Or relearn, says Matthew Tutimez, a diner from California.
In Los Angeles, we've been so removed from our ability to have our indigenous foods that we could not have a meal like this.
He's a biologist for the Kitch Gabrielino Band of Mission Indians in the Los Angeles Basin area, and was thrilled to see things like corn that's been nishtamalized or treated in an alkaline solution.
It's a process that our tribe did for thousands of years. And what this is actually within grains, such as acorn, such as corn, they have a layer that needs to be removed. So in order for this product to actually be nutritious, you have to remove that. Every tribe had this component. It was like our chicken soup.
Far cry from conditions across Indian country today, says Sherman.
You know, our focus is indigenous communities. So, you know, some of these communities can have upwards to 60% type 2 diabetes because of the nutritional access that they have around foods.
Owamni is the latest chapter for Thompson, whose heritage is Dakota, and Sherman, who's Oglala Lakota, and their sous chef enterprise, as in S-I-O-U-X.
Do you want me to sign this book for you?
His cookbook with that title won a James Beard Award in 2018. They also run a nonprofit that includes the Indigenous Food Lab, providing education and training. Wherever possible, they source from and help create new tribal suppliers.
Like all of our bisons coming out of Cheyenne River, and we're getting a lot of fish from a couple of the northern Anishinaabe tribes like Red Lake and Red Cliff. And we're just really trying to create a demand.
We're continuing to build them up. That's a big core part of our nonprofit, is acting as an entrepreneur generator.
Someday those entrepreneurs could include staffers at Owamni, where indigenous people are in the majority.
We had about a handful of our quinoa.
Daryl Montana moved here from Los Angeles initially just to train at the nonprofit. Then he was offered a job here.
So I basically packed up everything and moved to Minneapolis for this unique and exciting opportunity.
What do you see yourself doing in 10 years or 20 years?
I would actually like to, you know, to keep spreading the word about our indigenous meals and our indigenous chefs and our indigenous cooking, going back to what our forefathers grew up on, what they foraged, what they hunted, how it was 100 times more healthier than what they're eating now, processed and sodium-based, just unhealthy food.
I'm gonna plate it right now, so I'm ready to go.
Eddie Lone Eagle is another alumnus of the Indigenous Food Lab.
I'm Ojibwe from Red Lake, Minnesota. Growing up, I always wanted to make indigenous foods. I really didn't know much about it, you know. I just cook it with pride.
Alexa Wyatt, whose heritage includes Shawnee and Pawpaw, is the events manager at Owamni.
Bringing my grandmother up here from Oklahoma, that happened a few months ago, and I watched her cry when she was eating one of the dishes, and she's like, this reminds me of when I was a child.
And we're just kind of setting forth a path of how we can steward Indigenous knowledge, reclaim Indigenous knowledge, and practice it in real time, and be a role model for what that looks like right now today, and doing it through something as simple, I wouldn't say simple, but something like a restaurant, which is far from simple.
It's a heavy lift. New restaurants, like most small businesses, have a high failure rate. At Owamni, so far so good, say Thompson and Sherman. There hasn't been a day since opening last July that they've not been fully booked. For the PBS NewsHour, this is Fred DeSanLazaro in Minneapolis.
For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular has been offering no-contract wireless plans designed to help people do more of what they like. Our U.S.-based customer service team can help find a plan that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
The Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
PBS. Stream the best of PBS on any device with the PBS Video app. All your favorite drama, history, science, news, and documentaries all in one place. Watch your PBS station live or catch up on the shows you missed. Support your PBS station and you can get Passport, giving you full seasons.